How old are you?
How old am I?
Yeah.
I'm 90 years old.
What was life like when you were a little girl?
Oh, God, I've forgotten so much. I've forgotten so much. I'm very sorry.
No, it's okay. What have you forgotten?
I've forgotten what I used to do after I became a young lady. I've forgotten so much. I can't remember. I've been here 90 years. And if I could remember, I would tell you, but I can't remember.
I want to try an experiment.
What?
I want you to try and let the music take you back into your memories. To travel back into time. And then we'll stop and you can tell me where it took you.
Okay.
You ready?
Mm-hmm.
Yes, I want to be in that number. I win the same.
Wow. Oh, he's singing When the Saints Go By, marching by. And it takes me back to my school days.
I would like to hit the number.
Mama told us not to go listen to him. We would sneak off at night, bring back pictures from the dance. And I worked in King's County 9 years. He built in King's County. My birthday, November 20th, 19. I was in the wartime. I was working at Fort Jackson. And my son, on February the 4th, was 69. I didn't know I could talk so much.
This is Dan Cohen. 6 years ago, he volunteered at a nursing home. And what he experienced there changed his life. Dan asked me to film him for one day.
Adjusting the camera.
He wanted to show people what he was seeing. What was happening when he gave elders with dementia the music they had loved.
Happens when you get old is all the things you're familiar with and your identity are all just being peeled away.
What unfolded that first day moved me so much. I ended up following Dan for 3 years.
Did you work with elderly people before?
Well, I'm a social worker, and so I have worked with elderly people when I was actually for my internship, but it really wasn't most of my life I spent in the computer industry.
Oh, okay.
And this is sort of, for me, putting two things I love together. We really want to learn what music someone's going to really recognize and enjoy.
One of the residents is a resident who likes gospel music. Church was all his life. And I think that we can start with him.
Henry, speak to me.
Mm-hmm. I want to hear your voice. Mm-hmm. Can you talk to me? Mm-hmm. So let me hear you. Tell me your full name.
Henry has dementia and he needs total assistance with all his activities of daily living.
Hi, Papa.
Huh?
How you doing?
I'm all right. I'm fine.
Who,
wait.
Who am I?
Huh?
Who am I? I'm your daughter.
Daughter?
Mm-hmm. Which one?
Wait a minute. I got so many, I don't know. God,
you got so many?
Yes.
Maybe
yes.
Granddaughters.
Well, that's what I mean. Now, this, I don't.
Okay, it's Cherry.
How long has he been in the nursing home? Approximately 10 years. It affects him greatly because he was always, you know, fun-loving, singing, you know, every occasion he would come out with a song. I remember as a child, he used to walk us down the street, me and my brother, and he would stop and do Singing in the Rain. He would have us jumping and swinging around poles. He was, you know, he was good. He was always into music, you know, always loved singing, dancing.
You want your music now? Let's try your music, okay? And then you tell me if it's too loud or not, okay?
Music is inseparable from emotion. So it's not just a physiological stimulus. If it works at all, it will call the whole person, the many different parts of their brain, and the memories and emotions which go with it.
I will sing with this?
You can if you like.
When I first met him, he was very isolated, and he used to always sit on the unit with his head like this. He didn't really talk to much people, and then when I introduced the music to him, this is his reaction ever since.
Henry waking up did something to all of us. Everyone in the room felt it.
The philosopher Kant once called music the quickening art, and Henry is being quickened. He's being brought to life.
Yeah.
I'm going to take the music for 1 second, okay? Just to ask you a few questions, okay?
How awake was he?
I'm going to give it back to you.
Was he still lost in his dementia? Or had the music in some way changed that?
Henry.
Yeah?
Do you like the iPod? Do you like the music you're hearing?
Yes.
Tell me about your music.
Well, I don't have none, I mean.
Ask yes or no questions. Do you like music?
Yeah, I'm crazy about music. And you play beautiful music, beautiful sound.
Did you play music when you did you like music when you were young?
Yes, I went to big dances and things.
What was your favorite music when you were young?
Well, Cab Calloway was my number one band guy. I like it. That is the holy, the holy, the holy, the holy, the holy, the
holy. Henry.
Yeah?
What was your favorite song?
Oh, I'll be home there for Christmas. You can count plans on me with plenty of snow, mistletoe, present wrapped around your tree. Oh, Christmas Eve will carry me where that love light beamed.
Henry. Ma,
yeah.
What was the favorite part of your life? What was your favorite part of your life?
Bro, my life. It was part of my life was riding a bicycle. Grocery boy.
What'd you like about riding a bicycle?
That's where I made my money.
So in some sense, Henry has reacquired his identity for a while through the power of music.
What does music do to you?
Give me the feeling of love. No man, figure right now the world need to come into music, singing. You got beautiful music here. Beautiful, oh, lovely. And I feel the band of love, dream. The Lord came to me, made me holy. I'm a holy man. So he gave me these sounds. I'll just say, I meet you. Let me see. Rosalie, won't you love me? Rosalie, won't you be sweet and kind?
What do you think happened with Henry? I mean, what did we just see happening with Henry?
We connected with Henry. We connected with Henry's self. You know, when you're in a nursing home or when you have Alzheimer's disease, you're really struggling with your own thoughts and confusion and anxiety.
Dan was excited. I was excited. What if all these people we'd seen could be awakened like Henry?
All of a sudden, everything falls into place. And you're right there with the music. You understand it. It's pleasurable. You're not thinking about anything else. You're not struggling.
Oh, how lovely.
This is no small problem. There are 5 million people in America with dementia. 10 million people spend a large part of their life caring for them. There are maybe 1 million people in nursing homes, losing their connection to life.
I'll give you a kiss. Come on, sweetheart. Dad. Hello. Johnny? Hey, Johnny. How are you?
I mean, isn't this desire, a desire to awaken another person to what they are, to what they could be, a deep part of being human?
How often does anybody have a chance to affect the lives of 1 million or more people? I'm hoping people are ready to come along on this journey.
Here you go, you hold this. There you go.
We all feel music is magic.
I feel like I'm one with the world.
But for those with dementia, it can be a back door into the mind.
The parts of the brain which are involved in remembering music and responding to music are not affected too much in Alzheimer's disease or other dementias.
Part of the reason why musical memories are so strong has something to do with the way music enters our brains in the first place.
Music has more ability to activate more parts of the brain than any other stimulus. Music seems to be a cultural invention which makes use of parts of the brain developed for other purposes. Not only auditory parts, but visual parts, emotional parts, and at a lower level in the cerebellum, or the basic parts for coordination.
When we are young, music records itself in our motions and emotions. Luckily, these are the last parts of the brain touched by Alzheimer's.
Great job.
Can we hold hands a little bit?
Ah, that's better. We're too far from each other.
For the patients with Alzheimer's. It has to be music which has a meaning for them and is correlated with memory and feeling.
And by exciting or awakening those pathways, we have a gateway to stimulate and reach somebody who otherwise is unreachable.
Yeah, it's not an easy life for you. I love you.
I love you too.
I have one resident that barely opened her eyes. She didn't respond. As much as I tried, I knew her for 2 years. No matter what I tried, massage wouldn't work, nothing worked. From when we got introduced to the iPods and the family told me the things that she liked, it was amazing once we put the iPod on her. She started shaking her feet. She started moving her head. Her son was just amazed. Okay, can we stop? Because now I'm getting OR. I'm seeing her all over again.
What we're spending on drugs that mostly don't work dwarfs what it would take to deliver personal music to every nursing home resident in America.
And you have to pause it to start it up again and hit the button again.
Couldn't be easier.
There you go.
Yes.
Okay.
So why don't these people have their music already?
Click on the white on the arrow.
And why does it take an outsider like Dan to get it for them?
In today's really crazy system, I can sit down and write out a script for $1,000 a month antidepressant. No problem. Nobody asks any questions. If I want to provide a person with a $40 personal music system, that will take a lot of work. Because personal music doesn't count as a medical intervention. You see what I'm saying? It's sort of a side thing over here. The real business, trust me, is in the pill bottle.
Open for me?
Our healthcare system imagines the human being to be a very complicated machine. And we figured out how to turn the dials. Blood pressure, oh, turn that down, you know? Blood sugar, oh, turn that down. We have medicines that can adjust the dials. We haven't done anything, medically speaking, to touch the heart and soul of a patient.
Gil?
Yes?
They want you upstairs. You have to come take your meds.
No,
you refused this morning, so they want you to come now and take them.
No.
Listen,
no.
You know it's important, okay?
No.
But look how you're acting, okay? You need your medication.
Well, Gil is a little different. As you could see, he's a big guy. He's a strong guy. When he gets agitated, we really need things in place that are going to work and work quickly.
My anger manifests itself very many different ways. The anger is there, but sometimes I can't express it. Yeah.
I like to think of distress as communication. If you give a highly sedating medication to that kind of a person, you're actually taking away the one avenue they have to tell you they have a problem. And the problem with that is you can turn a person who is engaged into a person who is withdrawn into themselves and no longer able to connect with the world around them.
I wish I had my freedom. It's the most important part. That is what makes me most pissed of all, that I can't go out.
The thing people lose most is those intangibles, the idea of choice and control.
We're going to do your medicine now, all right?
Just every aspect of what am I going to do next is dictated to you in most institutional environments.
Drink some of that.
And music creates spontaneity that you cannot create in an institution.
it takes you to a place where you can leave the regimen and go off in a world that you create and that you connect with on your own terms.
Hi, Gil.
Hi.
I've brought you your music that you requested. Hi. And put it on your ears, over your head. Does that fit okay?
Yeah.
Okay. And here's your iPod. All you have to do is click the center button one time. I think you're all set.
We're just in love tomorrow.
There is no pill that does that. The medicine can dim the spark or the light. It never brings it out. What they need is engagement. They need to succeed in the world around them.
So you want an iPod too?
First, what's an iPod? I don't know anything about electronics.
He has his favorite music, and it's playing. That's all it is. It's just, it's like your own jukebox.
Let's start.
He wants to see what it looks like, the iPod.
Small. Okay.
Denise is a bipolar schizophrenic. She's been with us for about 2 years.
I like Schubert. Ave Maria Schubert.
Denise doesn't hold back any emotion. Her joy is off the charts. Unfortunately, so is her sorrow and her anger. So she's very raw, she's very real.
Do you know what I'd like to do?
Denise is probably an extreme resident that we have here.
I'm being emphatic, and I have a very vivid imagination. I'm very resilient, but I drop. And I keep on trying, and I drop. But I never stop, and I drop. One of these days, I'm gonna drop and stay on the floor.
I couldn't believe the music let Denise push away her walker. She'd been using that walker every day for 2 years.
I'm following your lead.
I'm having fun.
Good. Me too.
It's surprising that a little music evokes this much joy. It only makes sense when you understand their isolation.
What happens when they come to a nursing home? What are their losses?
I never thought I would be in a situation like this.
They lose their independence. It's sad to say, but sometimes they lose their dignity.
That's it.
Sometimes they're dealing with the loss of a loved one. Imagine losing that all in one day.
I want to get home.
Yeah, you do?
I've been here for the last 2 or 3 days.
Right. What do you want to do at home?
Be with my family.
Where are we going?
Right down here.
People have been here for years that have dementia. They'll still tell you, this is not where I live.
Yeah, I can go out this room too.
Tom has been in this nursing home for 5 years now.
So they're always trying to escape.
I have to go that way.
They're looking for the exits. That's one of the most frequently asked questions is, how do I get out of here?
I do. Can't get out here either, right?
Because this isn't their normal world when they come here. Now they're in this world, and this isn't the world that I know.
It's dark.
With few choices, little hope for the future, no control over the medications flowing through them, is it any surprise their minds struggle to adapt?
People close their eyes and withdraw inward more and more. If the outside world is horrible, I go to the inside to restore my balance. But after a while, people just become living dead people. They go into vegetation. And this does not have to be. No.
I play music.
I know, you're a trumpet player, right?
Yeah, and I play in a band.
I want you to come sit up here for a few minutes.
What I've found is that we all have music in us. And when we go through what we go through, like trauma caused by disease, caused by wars, that gets covered up. And I found a way of accessing that with some people. So it's really to help them find that song that they've covered up from the pain so they can sing again.
Samete was a volunteer who seemed to have a deep understanding of how music can heal trauma.
I've had a situation where I was actually overwhelmed. I was in the Congo. These people were told that this guy is coming to bring music, the healing power of music, which was a little overwhelming because these were about 150 women who had just gone through rape, who had just gone through the worst abuses you could ever imagine. I think I was inspired, actually, because I picked up the flute and I played a really sad melody, and the melody came from the pain that I knew these women had been subjected to. And when I finished the flute, I could see tears running down on some of the women's faces. And the next place that I knew that I had to take them was to sing a happy song. So I kicked into And soon they started moving a little bit, and soon they were clapping. And I'm telling you, 3 hours later, we're still singing. And now we're all connected. We're all just one body, everybody just singing. When I go to nursing homes, they remember these amazing stories, but it's always through music that they're able to express themselves, and that reminds those people, we will have a chance to be happy again.
Music had always been a big part of my life. When When I was younger, I played the trumpet, I played the organ, I played the piano. When I went off to college in the early 70s, I had the requisite giant album collection, which I carried through to my marriage. When I ended up here, I lost all of my music. My world became this facility.
This is solitary confinement. And every human being needs stimulation from the outside, from little babies to old people. If you find the music that the people know, there's stimulation, communication, and people do not withdraw inward.
Like many people in this institution, Steve found himself alone.
After 8 years of being here, I finally had the opportunity to get my music.
Okay, how's that? Good?
Vistas, which I thought were closed to me, opened up.
Have you ever had music just hit you in a place that immediately brought you to tears and you don't understand why? You know, music has that power. I can remember being 5 years old, hearing this music in the distance, crawling to it. It was Rhapsody on the theme of Paganini. You know, crawling to the music, laying on the floor and crying.
Music touches us all. How deep does it run inside of us?
Right.
When does our relationship with music begin? At 22 days, a single cell jolts to life. This first beat awakens nearby cells, and incredibly, they all begin to beat in perfect unison. These beating cells divide and become your heart. This desire to beat in unison seemingly fuels our entire lives. Amazingly, after 6 months of development, the cerebral cortex is capable of supporting thought.
Yeah, all the ladybugs are super cute.
Researchers have studied the sounds of newborns and discovered that in their cries are patterns that reflect their mother's speech.
I know you wouldn't bring it.
This means that even before we're born, we are learning how to sing with another human being.
I wondered how everyone knows that, regardless of what country I'm in. It seems like everyone knows that. Now, how is that possible if it wasn't already inside you?
Every child will tend to keep time to music heard or imagined, which you will not see in a chimpanzee. Music seems to be almost as quintessentially human as language. This response to a beat may be hardwired and human, and I think almost all human beings will bring out their inherent musicality.
'77.
You have a little bit of room to grow.
I've got a lot of room to grow, considering it will hold 2,000 songs.
That's right.
Do you have the piano man?
Piano man.
It's thrilling to me to be able to see a person who's been without music for years and then watch how that person comes alive. I mean, that's, as a physician, that's a thrill. But there's something behind that wonderful moment. I mean, how did that happen in the first place? Why were we able to feed and water and medicate this person, but not respond to deeply human needs that he might have?
A century ago, they were called nursing homes because you received nursing care, and most of the time it was in a home-like setting. That was before, I guess, our civilization advanced to the point where we created 15,000 nursing homes based on a hospital model.
How did this become the way millions of Americans end their life?
The civilization of the past 100 years, with its startling industrial changes, has tended more and more to make life insecure.
Technology has radically transformed the human environment. Our safety, no longer tied to the home or the village, became tied to something else. We became urban, and the traditional family structures began to feel pressure and weaken. As a consequence, by the late 1800s, elders in alarming numbers were ending their days in the poorhouse, alongside the insane and the homeless.
This social security measure gives at least some protection to 30 million of our citizens who will reap direct benefits through old age pensions.
There was a real awareness that older people in America were sick and poor. And a decision was made to support them, not through the welfare system, but through the healthcare system. And so what we had was this incredible shotgun marriage of the poorhouse and a hospital. And that's what nursing homes became.
A new industry was born. This business exploded after the Medicaid Act of 1965.
The idea of taking care of elders on a mass scale was something new in human history, and it was bound to run into problems. Early on, there were accusations of warehousing elders, overusing physical restraints, and even when reformers challenged that practice and reduced it, a new problem came up: the overuse of antipsychotic drugs. These drugs aren't designed for use with elders, and yet they're being massively overused in nursing homes.
Kiss me. Thank you.
American nursing homes actually have some of the best people in our nation. Some of the biggest hearts, most generous spirit, greatest joy and laughter. I love these people. However, they go to work every day inside an institution that defines people in terms of their diagnoses and their disabilities and thinks of them as patients first, human beings second.
He doesn't really initiate conversation. He just kind of exists.
Does he already have music in his room? Does he have a radio, CD player?
I don't think anything? He has a radio in his room, no.
He has dementia.
Mm-hmm.
Yes.
He has dementia.
Johnny, can you tell us, who is this guy? Who's that guy? Is that you when you were in the Navy?
Is that me?
Yeah.
Do I look like that?
Yeah, that's you.
That's not too bad.
You have Capitol years and a lot of Tommy Dorsey, Big Band,
yes.
All of this stuff. Let me sort it out by Frank Sinatra.
How about this one?
We tried to learn John's story.
Who's that guy?
Not the same guy?
To help us find his deepest music.
I got more muscles.
But how do you do this for someone like John?
All right, what about this?
We were told a few things. He played baseball.
Oh, boy.
He'd been drafted and served at Los Alamos. It was there that the Army gave him shots for radiation poisoning, shots that caused all his hair to fall out. Lastly, after the war, he performed in Philadelphia under the stage name Larry Stewart. But we couldn't learn this from John. The sensory record, the movie that played only in John's mind called memory, is gone. His love, his dreams, gone. Who are we without our memory?
Oh, Johnny O, how perfect.
Heavens above, you make my sad heart jump with joy. And when you're near, I just can't sit still a minute. I'm so, oh, Johnny, please tell me, dear, what makes me love you so? You're not handsome, it's true, but when I look at you, I just go, oh, Johnny,
there was no way we could have known there was this much life inside of John.
Some enchanted evening, you may see someone. You may see a red eye.
You should have a voice like him.
Upon the
For Johnny, getting his music and a little focused attention,
you're quite the singer,
was all it took to awaken feelings he hadn't felt in years.
I love to do it.
When did you first sing? When you were young, did you sing?
I don't know.
No?
I'm just a small guy.
Yeah?
I'm crying.
Why? Sad?
I don't know. I love everybody around here. My gang. This is my gang.
This is your gang? Yeah. Does it make you happy to sing for us?
Yeah.
Half the people in nursing homes get no visitors, so it's not like family can do it. The nursing homes don't really have a ready budget for this. The government does not reimburse for music and iPods. And so it really needs to come from somewhere.
So, well, my ultimate goal is to make this a standard of care in all 16,000 nursing homes in the country. That's the goal.
Depends on the nursing home. Depends on how proactive the volunteer department is.
Is this something you'd want to explore for your own facilities?
Well, I have several concerns.
That you give it to 2 people and 10 people are going to want it, and I'm not going to be able to give it to them.
Frankly, how it's administered.
This is a very big place. We have 600 residents here.
Of course, is also a significant factor that we have to consider in every program.
So tell me, how can I help you today?
I'm looking for a donation.
Just 1 second here.
The research shows it, our experience shows it. There is no doubt that mainstreaming the use of personalized music using iPods.
Spoke to the senior vice president, and they, they have a no corporate philanthropy policy.
There are 16,000 nursing homes in the United States, and the challenge is getting it out there. And we can really use your help.
Sandra Day O'Connor talked to him about your project?
No, about Alzheimer's, support of Alzheimer's Association. Support for Alzheimer's.
She talked to the man himself?
Yeah.
And he said no?
Yeah. So what luck am I going to have?
How's the work going?
It's a struggle.
Yeah,
it's a struggle.
No kidding. I have to tell you, I'm one of the few people who actually really knows how you feel about this. Because a couple of decades ago, I got really charged up by this idea that we could bring plants and animals and children into the lives of elders. I had these same kind of experiences that you described where I could see people come alive. We had this dream that we just go door to door. But we couldn't penetrate sort of the fog of the nursing home. What you're doing is outside of conventional practice. And you have to, and if you're gonna be successful going forward, you have to understand how big a barrier that is.
We went looking for answers. It turns out we are not alone. There are lots of people who believe there's something fundamentally wrong with the American nursing home.
I think we are part of a movement that is much, much bigger. I want to work on culture change. I want to support culture change as a national priority.
Hi, Bonnie.
Hey, Dan, what's up?
How are you?
We value independence and have the hardest time, I believe, of any country with the concept of dependence. And so whereas other folks have integrated aging, we had a unique interest in saying, over there, I don't want to see it, I don't want to know about it.
Why are we changing now?
why are we changing now? Because it's not working. Because it's dehumanizing. And I think, quite frankly, I think baby boomers are saying, this is not acceptable. This is not how I want to be treated when I get older.
This was inspiring. But are we really interested in changing the way America ages?
You might not realize it, but the United States of America has only 6,000 geriatricians in a nation of 300 million people. Even worse, that number's not going up, it's going down.
This is unfortunate timing, because the challenges we're going to have to face are growing.
We're facing an epidemic of neurologic diseases on a global scale. A cheery thought. On this map, every country that's colored blue has more than 20% of its population over the age of 65. This is the world we live in. And this is the world your children will live in. For 12,000 years, the distribution of ages in the human population has looked like a pyramid with the oldest on top. It's already flattening out. By 2050, it's going to be a column and will start to invert. And this is why that's not entirely a good thing. Because over the age of 65, your risk of getting Alzheimer's or Parkinson's disease will increase exponentially. There are 5 million Alzheimer's patients in the United States. In the next 10 years, that number will come close to doubling. We do not have the facilities, we do not have the resources, financial or otherwise, to cope with that number of people suffering from dementia. We have to find a way to help them age in place in a healthy manner.
What do you call that?
It's a...
Knife? No. Fork or spoon?
She says, we just don't understand. And I think that's probably true. You end up being dependent on someone else for everything that you do. You can no longer write your name. You struggle reading. You lose small motor control. You can't even remember how to get in and out of your apartment or the elevator.
So do you remember where's the elevator? Maybe it's here?
Yeah, it could be, yes.
That's okay. True.
Yes, I think so.
Let's press. Okay. We go down or up?
We have to go down.
Okay, so do you want to press for me?
Oh, yes, here. This one?
Down,
I'm not
that's,
sure.
That's up?
Is that, so that's
this
down?
This is down, yes.
Okay. Oh, did I do that badly?
I don't think so. Do you see the light?
Yeah, I could see the light.
Okay.
For Mary Lou, loving her grandson is easy.
This is going to the what?
It's just everything else that is hard.
Really bad.
But surprisingly, even deep inside Alzheimer's, her capacity for love and affection remains strong.
I have lots of people to talk to me and do all that kind of thing. So, yeah, I...
Are you sad because other people don't have that?
Yes, yes. Of course, because how could I do things if I didn't have people with me? gets them.
This is a hard journey for you, huh?
Yeah. Well, my husband, he's wonderful.
Would you like to hear some music? Would you like to listen to some music?
Sure, why not?
What do you have, Dan?
Here you go.
I don't know how to do this.
Just straight over your ears and your head. Perfect. See a little button in the middle?
That's that?
Yeah, right in the middle. Click it once. There you go. Okay, so there's a tears of joy.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Just wanted to make sure.
Oh, yeah. That's the best thing I've ever had, this thing. This, I don't know how to say it. It's just, it can't get away from me if I'm in this place.
I thought you were going to grow wings.
I was trying.
We wanted to believe that music would help Mary Lou stay with her family longer. We didn't know if it could do this until we met Norman and Nell.
Nell and I have been able to avoid long-term care for a number of years by trying to keep her constantly stimulated. Music has been an enormous part of it.
Then you'll play the piano for us?
Yes, but I just want to be with you a lot.
Okay.
Do you mind?
Absolutely not. I love that.
Norman has cared for Nell at home for 10 years without drugs. Without personalized music, Nell would be in an institution.
I've spent 38 years now working on Alzheimer's disease, and I haven't done anything for patients that's as effective as the music therapy is. I wish I had, and I'm still trying, but I really haven't seen anything as positive as that.
Mary Lou and Nell have family. Imagine having to navigate this on your own, far from your home. Denise got a message to us that she wanted us to come back.
I'm having fun.
Good.
That she had something to tell us. And we came.
Dad, how are you?
I'm fine. How are you?
Because we knew no one else visits her.
It's a letter from the hospital describing her condition. Metastasis.
That means that it has spread.
Yes.
because of that, I think it's very serious.
Yeah, it is very serious.
You know, life goes on. It goes on. Whether you die or not, it goes on. And I cannot accept that I don't leave something in this world for somebody. I cannot accept that. Do you understand what I'm saying?
It's painful to feel that what you have to give is not needed. That there's no one there to receive your gifts. In our past, in all our stories, in other cultures, elderhood had something to give. And there was always someone there who needed what elders had to give. Is this true in our new world? Does elderhood have a place?
We're taught from a very early age that adulthood is the pinnacle of existence. And that older people are really just broken down versions of their former incredible selves. We've built a culture that prizes individuals who are able to emulate the success of machines, that can be machine-like in how they live. This is not good news for aging, I have to say. Because aging is not a machine-like endeavor. And it's the fact that they're moving into a different way of living that causes America to put them away, to hide them away. What I've learned over a career of working with older people is that American culture is wrong. There is actually life beyond adulthood. There's actually the opportunity to live and grow and become elders.
Every Indian people, also all world people, very happy, very happy. Also, Shiva happy. Bolia Hara, Hara, Hara,
Hara. We are made to age. And the aging that we experience actually holds in it very important learnings and lessons.
There is a touch that takes a lifetime to achieve. Locking this touch away is like stripping from ourselves part of being human.
These people that we see in this nursing home, their spirits are dumped on because we're locking them away. But when you bring the music, that spirit is what you see that comes out. The spirit is still fresh and young.
My pain is very painful.
Oh, sorry.
But you know what?
What?
I can take a lot of pain.
You look like a very strong person.
I am. Yeah. A very strong person. Yes.
Isn't it? need to have that person in front of you who you're gonna be sharing with.
Keep playing.
It's not something you can just reach on. You have to completely open yourself up. You give yourself. And once you give yourself, then it opens up dialogue.
Take this off, please. Now, when you go back to Uganda,
yeah,
they'll ask you who gave you that. What are you going to say?
The strongest woman I've ever met.
Dan was breaking through.
So
he received a grant to give matching funds to 35 nursing homes.
And it's Colorado.
Yeah.
Okay, then Colorado. So that's good.
That's fabulous.
And this time, the nursing homes were lining up.
Gosh, how many different states? This is going to be just amazing.
Oh, yeah. Here we have 50 headphones, and this represents 50 changed lives. It's great. A lot of music.
After 3 years of filming, Dan had music in 56 homes. We knew this was just a drop in the bucket.
Just changing something in a nursing home somewhere, it doesn't take you far enough. Our real focus of concern needs to be the 1.6 million people who are living in nursing homes and how to make the lives of everyone better.
I thought this was just going to be just like that. People would just take the idea and run with it. They didn't.
I left Dan knowing he would never stop. I hoped maybe he'd reach the right person and they would help him and this dream of his would come true.
We first see Henry unresponsive and almost unalive.
Henry?
Yes, sir.
I found your music.
Then he is given his favorite music.
Oh.
And immediately he lights up. His face assumes expression, his eyes open wide, and he's being animated by the music.
This is his reaction ever since.
Do you like music?
Yeah, I'm crazy about music. You play beautiful music, beautiful sounds.
What does music do to you?
It'll give me the feeling of love. No matter. Figure right now, the world needs to come into music, singing. You got beautiful music here. And I feel the band of love. Dream.
You know that little video that I made for Dan, right? I think some kid posted it onto Reddit.com, and it's insane.
And I'm getting swamped. I'm behind by 85 emails, 85 people contact me. And if I had 300 people, I mean, it's just, you know.
Man, you gotta scroll down and just read what these people are saying. You've never heard anybody write anything like this. It's crazy.
My grandma's very much like Henry.
I've been trying nearly everything to get her more alert and happy.
My grandfather died so 3 days ago.
Music has so much power. Her eyes lit up instantly and the smile on her face made my day.
I haven't cried yet,
I bought her a CD,
but this has
today
made me start tearing up.
She was so emotional.
Maybe if this worked for Henry, it could work for my grandmother.
When the music ended, my
she
mother
got
looked
so
up
emotional and
she
so
saw
caught
me
up in the music. And
I'll
it
hold
was
that
so
memory forever.
The music carried her away.
I have to do this. I'm going home to see my mother with Alzheimer's.
She is, at this moment, listening to Ray Charles sing Come Rain or Come Shine, and she has found her place in the world again.
Are you okay?
back in your life, Mama.
Were you surprised that clip went viral? I mean, millions and millions of people have seen it. Completely surprised.
People just, they watched it. They saw a human being come alive. And when any of us come alive, it touches us deeply.
And that's why we want to involve the community, both in getting iPods donated and having the students come into the nursing homes to work with the residents, find their playlist.
We've been afraid to enter these places. Afraid of aging. Afraid of having nothing to give. But music, entering one 94-year-old man, reminded us. We do have something to give.
Oh, my friend.
How are you?
All we have to do is ask, what's your favorite song?
Vinny, what's your favorite song?
What was your favorite song?
Remember this?
Blackbird singing in the dead. That's a lovely one.
That's a beautiful song.
Yeah, beautiful. Well, I have to have that one.
That's right. Ed Sullivan
Show.
Look how fast her mind is responding to her songs.
When the night has come,
that's big.
And the land is dark.
In music, Mary Lou feels like she's perfect again. Like she's flowing through life. And so it is for all of us. Music gives us something we hunger deeply for. Something we've pursued for thousands of years. Rewired our very brains for. We need music. It awakens in us our most profound safety. The safety of living in concert with each other and our own selves.
And what happens to you when you hear it? When you hear it?
I feel good. It's like I got a girl. I want to stay with her.
And that is why, together, we're going to do this one small kindness. We're going to bring life into the places where it's been forgotten. And together,
whoa.
We will listen.
Everybody wants safety.
Safety, love.
sits with me over heartache and rage. Come set us free over panic and strange. I wanna see our bodies burning like old big sun.
Henry, thank you very much.
Yes. Oh, thank you.
Rhapsody on the theme of Paganini. You know, crawling to the music, laying on the floor and crying.
Music touches us all. How deep does it run inside of us? When does our relationship with music begin? At 22 days, a single cell jolts to life. This first beat awakens nearby cells, and incredibly, they all begin to beat in perfect unison. These beating cells divide and become your heart. This desire to beat in unison seemingly fuels our entire lives. Amazingly, after 6 months of development, the cerebral cortex is capable of supporting thought.
Yeah, all the ladybugs are super cute.
Researchers have studied the sounds of newborns and discovered that in their cries are patterns that reflect their mother's speech. This means that even before we're born, we are learning how to sing with another human being.
I wondered how everyone knows that, regardless of what country I'm in. It seems like everyone knows that. Now, how is that possible if it wasn't?
People with who they have been, who they are, and their lives. Because what happens when you get old is all the things you're familiar with and your identity are all just being peeled away.
What unfolded that first day moved me so much. I ended up following Dan for 3 years.
Did you work with elderly people before?
Well, I'm a social worker, and so I have worked with elderly people when I was actually for my internship, but it really wasn't most of my life I spent in the computer industry.
Oh, okay.
And this is sort of, for me, putting two things I love together. We really want to learn what music someone's going to really recognize and enjoy.
One of the residents is a resident who likes gospel music. Church was all his life. And I think that we can start with him.
Henry, speak to me. I want to hear your voice. Can you talk to me? So let me hear you. Tell me your full name.
Henry has dementia, and he needs total assistance with all his activities of daily living.
Hi, Papa. Hi, Papa.
Huh?
How you doing?
I'm all right. I'm fine.
Who,
wait.
Who am I?
Huh?
Who am I? I'm your daughter.
Daughter?
Mm-hmm. Which one?
Wait a minute. I got so many, I don't know. God,
you got so many?
Yes.
Maybe granddaughters.
Well, that's what I mean. Now, this, I don't.
Okay, it's Cherry. How long has he been in the nursing home?
In another person. To what they are. To what they could be. A deep part of being human.
How often does anybody have a chance to affect the lives of a million or more people? I'm hoping people are ready to come along on this journey.
Here you go, you hold this. There you go.
We all feel music is magic.
I feel like I'm one with the world.
But for those with dementia, it can be a back door into the mind.
The parts of the brain which are involved in remembering music and responding to music are not affected too much in Alzheimer's disease or other dementias.
Part of the reason why musical memories are so strong has something to do with the way music enters our brains in the first place.
Music has more ability to activate more parts of the brain than any other stimulus. Music seems to be a cultural invention which makes use of parts of the brain developed for other purposes. Not only auditory parts, but visual parts, emotional parts, and at a lower level in the cerebellum, or the basic parts for coordination.
When we are young, music records itself in our motions and emotions. Luckily, these are the last parts of the brain touched by Alzheimer's.
Wait,
Can we hold hands a little bit? Ah, that's better. We're too far from each other.
For the patients with Alzheimer's, it has to be music which has a meaning for them and is correlated with memory and feeling.
And by exciting or awakening those pathways, we have a gateway to stimulate and reach somebody who otherwise is unreachable.
Yeah, it's not an easy life for you. I love you.
I love you too.
I have one resident that barely opened her eyes. She didn't respond.
When does our relationship with music begin? At 22 days, a single cell jolts to life. This first beat awakens nearby cells, and incredibly, they all begin to beat in perfect unison. These beating cells divide and become your heart. This desire to beat in unison seemingly fuels our entire lives. Amazingly, after 6 months of development, the cerebral cortex is capable of supporting thought.
Yeah, all the ladybugs are super cute.
Researchers have studied the sounds of newborns and discovered that in their cries are patterns that reflect their mother's speech.
I know, I have you in the
This means that even before we're born, we are learning how to sing with another human being.
I wondered how everyone knows that, regardless of what country I'm in, it seems like everyone knows that. Now, how is that possible if it wasn't already inside you?
Every child will tend to keep time to music heard or imagined, which you will not see in a chimpanzee. Music seems to be almost as quintessentially human as language. This response to a beat may be hardwired.
A couple of years, I mean, a lot of Tommy Dorsey, big band,
yes.
All of this stuff, let me sort it out by Frank Sinatra.
How about this one?
We tried to learn John's story.
Who's that guy?
Is that the same guy?
To help us find his deepest music.
I got more muscles.
But how do you do this for someone like John?
All right, what about this?
We were told a few things. He played baseball.
Oh, boy.
He'd been drafted and served at Los Alamos. It was there that the Army gave him shots for radiation poisoning, shots that caused all his hair to fall out. Lastly, after the war, he performed in Philadelphia under the stage name Larry Stewart. But we couldn't learn this from John. The sensory record, the movie that played only in John's mind called memory, is gone. His love, his dreams, gone. Who are we without our memory?
Oh, Johnny O, how perfect.
Above, you make my sad heart jump with joy. And when you're near, I just can't sit still a minute. I'm so, oh, Johnny, please tell me, dear, what makes me love you so? You're not handsome, it's true, but when I look at you, I just, oh, Johnny,
there was no way we could have known there was this much life inside of John.
Some enchanted evening, you may see someone. You may see a friend.
You should have had a voice like him.
Upon the night.
For Johnny, getting his music and a little focused attention.
You're quite the singer.
Was all it took to awaken feelings he hadn't felt in years.
I love to do it.
This is individuals who are able to emulate the success of machines. They can be machine-like in how they live. This is not good news for aging, I have to say. Because aging is not a machine-like endeavor. And it's the fact that they're moving into a different way of living that causes America to put them away, to hide them away. What I've learned over a career of working with older people is that American culture is wrong. There is actually life beyond adulthood. There's actually the opportunity to live and grow and become elders.
Every Indian people, also all world people, very happy, very happy. All of you are happy.
We are made to age, and the aging that we experience actually holds in it very important learnings and lessons.
There is a touch that takes a lifetime to achieve. Locking this touch away is like stripping from ourselves part of being human.
These people that we see in this nursing home, their spirits are dumped on because we're locking them away. But when you bring the music, that spirit is what you see that comes out. The spirit is still fresh and young.
My pain is very painful.
Oh, sorry.
But you know what?
What?
I can take a lot of pain.
You look like a very strong person.
I am. Yeah. A very strong person. Yes.
Mm-hmm.
Spanish. You're not Spanish.
No, I'm not Spanish. I'm following your lead.
I'm having fun.
Good. Me too.
It's surprising that a little music evokes this much joy. It only makes sense when you understand their isolation.
What happens when they come to a nursing home? What are their losses?
I never thought I would be in a situation like this.
They lose their independence. It's sad to say, but sometimes they lose their dignity.
That's it.
Sometimes they're dealing with the loss of a loved one. Imagine losing that all in one day.
I want to get home.
Yeah, you do?
I've been here for the last 2 or 3 days.
Right. What do you want to do at home?
Be with my family.
Where are we going?
Right down here.
People have been here for years that have dementia. They'll still tell you, this is not where I live.
Yeah, I can go out this one too.
Tom has been in this nursing home for 5 years now.
So they're always trying to escape.
I have to go that way.
They're looking for the exits. That's one of the most frequently asked questions is, how do I get out of here?
I do. Can't get out here either, right?
Because this isn't their normal world when they come here. Now they're in this world, and this isn't the world that I know.
It's stuck.
With few choices, little hope for the future, no control over the medications flowing through them, is it any surprise their minds struggle to adapt?
People close their eyes and withdraw inward more and more. If the outside world is horrible, I go to the inside to restore my balance. But after a while, people just become living dead people.
What we're spending on drugs that mostly don't work dwarfs what it would take to deliver personal music to every nursing home resident in America.
And then we pause it to start it up again and hit the button again.
Couldn't be easier.
There you go.
Yes.
Okay.
So why don't these people have their music already?
Click on the white, on the arrow.
And why does it take an outsider like Dan to get it for them?
In today's really crazy system, I can sit down and write out a script for $1,000 a month antidepressant. No problem. Nobody asks any questions. If I want to provide a person with a $40 personal music system, that will take a lot of work. Because personal music doesn't count as a medical intervention. You see what I'm saying? It's sort of a side thing over here. The real business, trust me, is in the pill bottle.
Open for me?
All Our healthcare right. system imagines the human being to be a very complicated machine. And we figured out how to turn the dials. Blood pressure, oh, turn that down, you know? Blood sugar, oh, turn that down. We have medicines that can adjust the dials. We haven't done anything, medically speaking, to touch the heart and soul of a patient.
Gil?
Yes?
They want you upstairs. You have to come take your meds.
No.
No, you refused this morning, so they want you to come now and take them.
No.
Listen, no. You know it's important, okay?
No.
Look how you're acting, okay? You need your medication.
Well, Gil is a little different. As you could see, he's a big guy. He's a strong guy. When he gets agitated, we really need things in place that are going to work and work quickly.
Anger manifests itself very many different ways. The anger is there, but sometimes I can't express it.
I like to think of distress as communication. If you give a highly sedating medication to that kind of a person, you're actually taking away the one avenue they have to tell you they have a problem. And the problem with that is you can turn a person who is engaged into a person who is withdrawn into themselves and no longer able to connect with the world around them.
I wish I had my freedom. It's the most important part. That is what makes most
on with the American Nursing Home.
I think we are part of a movement that is much, much bigger. I want to work on culture change. I want to support culture change as a national priority.
Hi, Bon.
Hey, Dan, what's up?
How are you?
We value independence and have the hardest time, I believe, of any country with the concept of dependence. And so whereas other folks have integrated aging, we had a unique interest in saying, over there, I don't want to see it, I don't want to know about it.
Why are we changing now?
Why are we changing now? Because it's not working. Because it's dehumanizing. And I think, quite frankly, I think baby boomers are saying, this is not acceptable. This is not how I want to be treated when I get older.
This was inspiring. But are we really interested in changing the way America ages?
You might not realize it, but the United States of America has only 6,000 geriatricians in a nation of 300 million people. Even worse, that number's not going up, it's going down.
This is unfortunate timing, because the challenges we're gonna have to face are growing.
We're facing an epidemic of neurologic diseases on a global scale. A cheery thought. On this map, every country that's colored blue has more than 20% of its population over the age of 65. This is the world we live in. And this is the world your children will live in. For 12,000 years, the distribution of ages in the human population has looked like a pyramid with the oldest on top. It's already flattening out. By 2050, it's going to be a column and will start to invert. And this is why that's not entirely a good thing. Because over the age of 65, your risk of getting Alzheimer's or Parkinson's disease will increase exponentially. There are 5 million Alzheimer's patients in the United States. In the next 10 years, that number will come close to doubling. We do not have the facilities, we do not have the resources, financial or otherwise, to cope with that number of people suffering from dementia. We have to find a way to help them age in place in a healthy manner.
It gives us something we hunger deeply for. Something we've pursued for thousands of years. We wired our very brains for. We need music. It awakens in us our most profound safety, the safety of living in concert with each other and our own selves.
And what happens to you when you hear it? When you hear it?
I feel good. It's like I got a girl. I want to stay with her.
And that is why, together, we're going to do this one small kindness. We're going to bring life into the places where it's been forgotten. And together, we will listen.
I'm a man on fire, walking through your street with one guitar and two dancing feet. Only one desire that's left in me. Want the whole damn world to come dance with me.
This much life inside of John.
Some enchanted evening, you may see someone. You may see a red eye.
Wish I had a voice like him.
Upon the night.
For Johnny, getting his music and a little focused attention.
You're quite the singer.
Was all it took to awaken feelings he hadn't felt in years.
I love to do it.
When did you first sing? When you were young, did you sing?
I don't know.
No?
I'm just a small guy.
Yeah?
I'm crying.
Why? Sad?
I don't know. I love everybody around here. My gang, this is my gang.
This is your gang? Yeah. Does it make you happy to sing for us?
Yeah.
Half the people in nursing homes get no visitors, so it's not like family can do it. The nursing homes don't really have a ready budget for this. The government does not reimburse for music and iPods. And so it really needs to come from somewhere.
So, well, my ultimate goal is to make this a standard of care in all 16,000 nursing homes in the country. That's the goal.
Depends on the nursing home. Depends on how proactive the volunteer department is.
Is this something you'd want to explore for your own facilities?
Well, I have several concerns.
That you give it to 2 people and 10 people are going to want it and I'm not going to be able to give it to them.
Frankly, how it's administered.
This is a very big place. We have 600 residents here.
Cost is also a significant factor that we have to consider in every program.
Tell me, how can I help you today?
I'm looking for a donation.
Just 1 second here.
The research shows it, our experience shows it. There is no doubt that mainstreaming the use of personalized music using iPods.
Spoke to the senior vice president, and they have a no corporate philanthropy policy.
There are 16,000 nursing homes in the United States, and the challenge is getting it out there. And we can really use your help.
Sandra Day O'Connor, talked to him about your project?
No, about Alzheimer's, support of Alzheimer's Association.
support for Alzheimer's.
You struggle reading. You lose small motor control. You can't even remember how to get in and out of your apartment or the elevator.
So do you remember where's the elevator? Maybe it's here?
Yeah, it could be, yes.
That's okay. True.
Yes, I think so.
Let's press. Okay. We go down or up?
We have to go down.
Okay, so do you want to press for me?
Oh, yes, here. This one?
Down,
not
that's,
sure.
That's up?
Is that, so that's
this
down?
This is down, yes.
Okay. Oh, did I do that badly?
I don't think so. Do you see the light?
Yeah, I could see the light.
For Mary Lou, loving her grandson is easy.
This is going to the what?
It's just everything else that is hard.
Really bad.
But surprisingly, even deep inside Alzheimer's, her capacity for love and affection remains strong.
I have lots of people to talk to me and do all that kind of thing, so, yeah,
Are you sad because other people don't have that?
Yes, yes, of course, because how could I do things if I didn't have people with me? That's the...
This is a hard journey for you, huh?
Yeah. Well, my husband, he's wonderful.
Would you like to hear some music? Would you like to listen to some music?
Sure, why not?
What do you have, Dan? Here you go.
I don't know how to do this.
Just straight over your ears and your head. Perfect. See a little button in the middle?
What's that?
Yeah, right in the middle. Click it once. There you go. Round, round, get around, I get around. Yeah, get around, round, round, I get around. I get around, round, round, I get around.
Con mi música y mi canto, yo si te pongo a gozar. In Spanish. You're not Spanish.
No, I'm not Spanish. I'm following your lead.
I'm having fun.
Good. Me too.
It's surprising that a little music evokes this much joy. It only makes sense when you understand their isolation.
What happens when they come to a nursing home? What are their losses?
I never thought I would be in a situation like this.
They lose their independence. It's sad to say, but sometimes they lose their dignity.
That's it.
Sometimes they're dealing with the loss of a loved one. Imagine losing that all in one day.
I want to get home.
Yeah, you do?
I've been here for the last 2 or 3 days.
Right. What do you want to do at home?
Be with my family.
Where are we going?
Right down here.
People have been here for years that have dementia. They'll still tell you, this is not where I live.
Yeah, I can go at this one too.
Tom has been in this nursing home for 5 years now.
So they're always trying to escape.
I have to go that way.
They're looking for the exits. That's one of the most frequently asked questions is, how do I get out of here?
I do. Can't get out here either, right?
Because this isn't their normal world when they come here. Now they're in this world, and this isn't the world that I know.
It's dark.
With few choices, little hope for the future, no control over the medications flowing through them, is it any surprise their minds struggle to adapt?
People close their eyes and withdraw inward more and more. If the outside world is horrible, I go to the inside.
And accept that I don't leave something in this world for somebody. I cannot accept that. Do you understand what I'm saying?
It's painful to feel that what you have to give is not needed. That there's no one there to receive your gifts. In our past, in all our stories, in other cultures, elderhood had something to give. And there was always someone there who needed what elders had to give. Is this true in our new world? Does elderhood have a place?
We're taught from a very early age that adulthood is the pinnacle of existence. And that older people are really just broken down versions of their former incredible selves. We've built a culture that prizes individuals who are able to emulate the success of machines, that can be machine-like in how they live. This is not good news for aging, I have to say. Because aging is not a machine-like endeavor. And it's the fact that they're moving into a different way of living that causes America to put them away, to hide them away. What I've learned over a career of working with older people is that American culture is wrong. There is actually life beyond adulthood. There's actually the opportunity to live and grow and become elders.
Every Indian people, also all world people, very happy, very happy. All the Siva happy. Bolia Hara, 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 Hara.
We are made to age. And the aging that we experience actually holds in it very important learnings and lessons.
He wanted to show people what he was seeing, what was happening when he gave elders with dementia the music they had loved.
Thank you.
connects people with who they have been, who they are, and their lives. Because what happens when you get old is all the things you're familiar with and your identity are all just being peeled away.
What unfolded that first day moved me so much. I ended up following Dan for 3 years.
Did you work with elderly people before?
Well, I'm a social worker, and so I have worked with elderly people when I was actually for my internship, but it really wasn't most of my life I spent in the computer industry.
Oh, okay.
And this is sort of, for me, putting two things I love together. We really want to learn what music someone's going to really recognize and enjoy.
One of the residents is a resident who likes gospel music. Church was all his life. And I think that we can start with him.
Henry, speak to me. I want to hear your voice. Can you talk to me?
Mm-hmm.
So let me hear you. Tell me your full name.
Henry has dementia and he needs total assistance with all his activities of daily living.
Hi, Papa. Hi, Papa.
Huh?
How you doing?
I'm all right. I'm fine.
Who,
wait.
Who am I?
Huh?
Who am I? I'm your daughter.
She says, we just don't understand. I think that's probably true. You end up being dependent on someone else for everything that you do. You can no longer write your name. You struggle reading. You lose small motor control. You can't even remember how to get in and out of your apartment or the elevator.
So do you remember where's the elevator? Maybe it's here?
Yeah, it could be, yes.
That's okay. True.
Yes, I think so.
Let's press. We go down or up?
We have to go down.
Okay, so do you want to press for me?
Oh, yes, here. This one?
Down,
not
that's,
sure.
That's up?
Is that, so that's
this
down?
This is down, yes.
Okay. Oh, did I do that badly?
I don't think so. Do you see the light?
Yeah, I could see the light.
Okay.
For Mary Lou, loving her grandson is easy.
This is going to the what?
It's just everything else that is hard.
Really bad.
But surprisingly, even deep inside Alzheimer's, her capacity for love and affection remains strong.
I have lots of people to talk to me and do all that kind of thing. So, yeah,
Are you sad because other people don't have that?
Yes, yes. Of course, because how could I do things if I didn't have people with me? That's the...
This is a hard journey for you, huh?
Yeah. Well, my husband, he's wonderful.
Would you like to hear some music? Would you like to listen to some music?
Sure, why not?
What do you have, Dan?
Here you go.
I don't know how to do this.
Time is... It has to be music which has a meaning for them and is correlated with memory and feeling.
And by exciting or awakening those pathways, we have a gateway to stimulate and reach somebody who otherwise is unreachable.
Yeah, it's not an easy life for you. I love you.
I love you too.
I have one resident that barely opened her eyes. She didn't respond. As much as I tried, I knew her for 2 years. No matter what I tried, massage wouldn't work, nothing worked. From when we got introduced to the iPods and the family told me the things that she liked, it was amazing once we put the iPod on her. She started shaking her feet. She started moving her head. Her son was just amazed. Okay, can we stop? Because now I'm getting OR. I'm seeing her all over again.
What we're spending on drugs that mostly don't work dwarfs what it would take to deliver personal music to every nursing home resident in America.
And then we pause it to start it up again and hit the button again.
Couldn't be easier.
There you go.
Yes.
Okay.
So why don't these people have their music already?
Click on the white on the arrow.
And why does it take an outsider like Dan to get it for them?
In today's really crazy system, I can sit down and write out a script for $1,000 a month antidepressant. No problem. Nobody asks any questions. If I want to provide a person with a $40 personal music system, that will take a lot of work. Because personal music doesn't count as a medical intervention. You see what I'm saying? It's sort of a side thing over here. The real business, trust me, is in the pill bottle.
Open for me?
All Our healthcare right. system imagines the human being to be a very complicated machine